Despite months of design, planning, and assembly, Saab and the all-important gowns arrive in Paris just 48 hours before the collection debuts. Barely off the plane, dozens of shortlisted models from an initial batch of thousands descend at the company's Paris studio, where Elie and a team established after years in the industry must decide who has the right look for the collection, the versatility to wear multiple dresses, and of course, the walk. But what everyone really wants to know is who gets to wear the pièce de résistance, the final gown of the show, one that has become Saab's trademark and often sends shockwaves through the industry.
How do you choose the right girl for the dress?
Normally, I have the girls in mind, and we leave always like in rotation, like four girls you can play.
For each look?
Yes.
For each look.
And this all takes time.
So what's the theme of the collection?
The theme is a ball in the French palace.
And this is what you would wear if you were going to a French
minimum.
Palace. Do you guys feel like you're going to a palace?
Oh yeah, yes. Always. Every day. Yeah.
But while it might be the gowns themselves that steal the show, as the Saab empire expands into the ready-to-wear market, it's the accessories the company expects could really move the bottom line.
So tell me, always the belts. Why the belts? Why do you love them?
Because me, I adore the waist of the woman, the more feminine place. In the body of a woman, it's a waist. Like the signature of femininity for me.
It's like an hourglass.
And although you might think with the gowns assigned and the accessories in place, the collection is all but locked down, think again. Saab's team will be up into the small hours, retailoring the gowns and timing the show, whilst dozens more oversee construction of the venue.
Is it when you're the most creative at the very end?
No, maybe I feel more every small details, and I'm more picky and I see better.
But while Elie Saab still leads the creative process, in recent years the business has become very much a family affair, with his wife and sons now part of the entourage.
So your wife and your son, obviously quite involved in the process. Does your wife get final cut? She get to say, I like this, I don't like that?
No, she feels something amiss, because we see in the same direction. I feel it's very important, like she's here to see with me.
So family is very important to this process.
The family for me is the more important things in life.
We're just 48 hours away from the debut of your haute couture collection on the catwalk here in Paris. Are you nervous?
Always. Yes, always. Today I'm so nervous. I pass by moment and I feel normal. I'm always like that.
So just to the last minute, you're changing things around.
Sure. Wow. Because me, I believe in the last minute. I feel like I work better in the tension.
Is there a market specifically that you want to broaden your scope, like the United States, like Asia? Is there somewhere that you want to be more involved than you are right now?
We work to be involved in all the market, especially in state. All the women come to Paris and to for the haute couture. We have a lot of American, Chinese, Brazilian now. They want to have the haute couture dresses. And for that, we work on the development in state and China and everywhere in the world.
The women that are coming to you from Asia, from China specifically, are they coming to Paris? Are they coming to Beirut?
No, we are present in Hong Kong also, but for the haute couture, the second place to have haute couture is Paris.
Some of your peers in the industry, in the fashion industry, like Michael Kors, for example, has something called affordable luxury. And that is something where every woman can go to one of his shops and purchase a bag or purchase a belt or a dress, and it's an affordable luxury item. Is that somewhere that you would see your brand eventually going, to affordable luxury, or would you rather stay in the purely luxury space?
With the product, me, I prefer to stay in the luxury. But I like to create a lot of items. Like the perfume is a kind of marketing or kind of affordable item for all the woman what?
More of a lifestyle. Yes, but, so it's every day you're not in an Elie Saab gown, but every day you're wearing Elie Saab.
No, we work to have our day wear also, but always I want to stay in the luxury product.
For the fashion industry as a whole, it's more of a global environment. You know, if you like a designer in Paris, you can get that designer now in Asia, in the United States. What do you think is the next big thing?
No, I believe now, like, the world is open, it's more open. But I don't believe like the code of the houses, it's changed. Because it can be a house now, a very, very success story for 2-3 years, and after you don't...
He's gone.
You understand? And me, I don't like to be in this stage, because trust me, it's very easy to do a hit for a small period of time.
When you built your first atelier until now, you've never had outside financial backers. You've done this all of yourself.
Yeah.
Have there been drawbacks to that because of the growth of the brand? You could, if you had taken investors, you could have gone faster, or was it better because you controlled it?
I don't feel like my way it's slowly, because honestly, to move from haute couture to prêt-à-porter to accessory, it's all like every single department, it's a big step. Yeah.
You had your first collection in Paris in 2000, your first runway collection on the catwalk. Did you know then how big the brand was going to be?
Sure.
You already knew you were going to be this big?
Sure.
When you had that first, you knew?
Yeah, sure.
How did you know?
I know.
I'm not arguing. No. I'm just saying. How did you know?
Sure. No. From the first presentation in Paris, already the vision and the target, what I want, it's very clear, and I work on it